Still talking COVID-19, it is pertinent that we look at it, the pandemic, in another light as it affects us globally. And on this particular set is Otumba Bimbo Ashiru, a former Commissioner of Commerce and Industry in Ogun State and Director Odua Investment Company Limited, Nigeria. I am Olujoke and thank you for always watching Let's Talk. The topic for today is COVID-19 economic implication in comparative analysis. So, Otumba, thanks for joining me on this show.
Thank you, Joke, for having me on your program.
All right. Now, we know what is going on around the world right now, and which is actually COVID-19. It's something that has called for a world's attention. So, my first question is, could you please give a general overview of COVID-19 as it affects the economy of nations of the world, especially the worst hit?
Thank you very much. I actually like that question. But what I want to tell you is that we didn't know that it's going to be like this. I mean, for the first time in the issue, I mean, in my own life, whereby the whole of the world, they cannot have a solution to it. And I can tell you, there is still no medicine to solve this virus, so which clearly shows that it's a big problem. And running of business is going to take a new dimension entirely. I will tell you, during this period, the people that are smiling to the bank, which I mentioned some time ago, are the food and beverages industry, the logistics industry, and actually technology. Zoom, Eric Yuan must be smiling to the bank now, the billions of dollars, because now things are done virtually. Meetings are held virtually. Look at me, I'm talking to you via Zoom. So it clearly shows that these are the people that are making money of it, and they are making the best of the bad situation. And that is it. And then different sectors have been affected: manufacturing, entertainment, and governance. Manufacturing, I mean, the food and beverages, they are doing very well, because, I mean, most of this we are talking about economic stimulus package. Most of in Nigeria, for example, the governor, I mean, the state government people, they are donating to the people. They call it palliative measures. And that is the only way, because, see, people are just, I mean, there's a lockdown. Nobody can go out, no work. This should be a pointer now, as the other Ethiopia cases have shown that. I was talking to someone recently. I said, you call them event planners. They have to look for other ways of doing business. The caterers, they have to look for other ways of doing business. And I'm happy that some of them are so smart enough, they've now started doing home delivery catering. And that's why I said the logistics company, the courier companies are making money, because nobody will leave their house. I mean, today, I had some packages, I mean, things I ordered for, from courier companies. So they are being paid. So it clearly shows that things will be done that way. And the other thing is that we have to work from home. We have to learn. We have to learn how to shop, how to work from home, how we use technology, and changing. They're all changing rapidly. So what I'm saying is that as a result of this, digital commerce is going to be coming, and it's the new norm. So what I'm saying is that people are increasingly adapting to it. Now, if you want to order for something, so any organization, any business, any retail outfit that doesn't have e-commerce so that people can go there online to order for your goods is a failure. There's a big conglomerate in England, I'm not going to mention the name, they are making a lot of money, but because they don't have online shopping, so they're having problems. They've lost billions of pounds. And those are the things that we need to look at. And I will give something to you. Companies that invest courageously and timely in pivoting their businesses towards the behavioral changes can capture market shares and emerge as market leaders post-pandemic. It was mentioned by Deloitte, I mean, an accounting firm, I mean, consultancy outfit. So it clearly shows that we will have to distinguish one business entity from another.
Okay, to further add up to the question earlier and discussed, what is the state of the small and medium enterprises and the micro, small and medium enterprises? We know that as a result of this lockdown, especially most of this, the fashion houses, the hairdressers, the salons, basically, and other small businesses cannot operate. Now, in this regard, how would you say, because I believe these small, medium enterprises are actually a vital part of the economy. But with this shutdown, a lot of things, as maybe businesses that are not working, has affected the economy. So what would you say, would you continue to encourage the small and medium enterprises? Because I remember you talking in a forum recently about agriculture. You were really emphasizing on agriculture. So would you say we should swap agriculture with these small-scale enterprises?
Okay, now I get your point, but let me explain to you. Wholesale and retail businesses will still succeed and survive in this post and during pandemic period. And I will explain to you. When I said small, medium enterprises, and like I said, that they must introduce digital technology and they must have introduced e-commerce. And I will give you the good example. You know, Nigeria, with a population of over 200 million people, retail and wholesale business will thrive in the sense that you are now going to use it for a dimension, a strategy, whereby people can order for their foods, clothes, online. In Nigeria today, people have started producing, the so-called fashion designers have now gone, they've into the other businesses, they are now producing jackets, clothes, preventive clothes for the medical people. Mm. And then they started, yes, and they started producing face masks, different designs in Ankara, in different designs. I have so many of these face masks in different designs. So it clearly shows that people are now looking at it. They are selling them for 400 naira, 500 naira, wholesale. And so, I bought about 100 recently. It's now giving them business. So small and medium businesses will thrive as long as people are using their own initiative. They are now introducing new dimension, new styles, and everything to run the business. So you must be digitally focused. Use of social media is going to try, and don't forget that the little cyber cafes, the social media, they are retail people. They are small businesses that are trying to thrive. And not only that, we now need to use the entertainment industry to maintain the opportunity. Research safe business event planning, like catering, hospitality businesses. We are now going to and leisure. They are the worst eat, but at the same time, you now start looking at different dimensions. Some of them are now using their homes to cook food and start selling them out. So you can make your order. I got an email recently and on my WhatsApp telling me menu for today and everything. So that is the way and that is the norm. But I'll tell you this. In this pandemic period, during this pandemic period and everything, the only business that will thrive easily is healthcare and pharmaceutical products. Food services, technology, which I've just spoke about, Zoom and everything. So what I'm saying is that you will see a lot of businesses thriving, but how do you get them done? You need to look at how you are going to have another ways of solving that and doing it. So my own point here is that business will thrive, but you must look at ways of getting things done. If you don't look at ways of them, you're going to have problems. So what it clearly shows is that you must be innovative. If you are not innovative, you cannot survive. If you are not innovative, you are not going to strive. So what you need to do now is to start looking for better ways of doing things. And look at some people that thought, as fashion designers, let us start sewing cover clothes and everything. And they are producing thousands, millions. So they are smiling to the bank too. So the point is that there are some businesses that will thrive at any point in time. Food industry will thrive, food and beverages. But agriculture is the norm, is the way, because you know that even if there is another pandemic in future, because like I told some people, this thing will continue with us. It's like having malaria, having flu. It's just that they have not been able to see the kind of medicine, vaccine, or how to build your immune system. Like I had people saying, take a lot of vitamin C, vitamin D, zinc, and what have you, garlic, ginger, blah, 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 so that all you need to do is to build your immune system. So what I'm saying in essence is that very soon, things will still come back to normal, to reality. Lockdown will be, the point is that the so-called lockdown, we have to be eased because we cannot sustain it as a country, as an economy. Mm. So we now need to look at ways of doing things. And like I said, it's a new norm. You now know, you can now, if you are going out, you must use face masks. If you are going to do this, you must do this. So those are the social distancing is there. When you're having parties now, for normally the table of 10, we now probably reduce to a table of 4 or 5. So the social distancing will be there. And if you're going to, like somebody put it in the video recently, that if you're going to spray at the party, you are the one, you are going to spray at the distance. So it's even eradicating some funny attitude that we have, that I think is not even liable. Spraying at parties, even all these things, will be reduced. So put the money in an envelope and just give it to them. That's the new norm now. Yeah.
All right. So while you were talking the other time also, you also mentioned, you know, there were stimulus packages in the U.S. Some countries call it stimulus, while some others say it's a relief package. And with all of that, even these developing countries that did relief package, we still have a lot of people who complained that they didn't get it. Now, if we know that, like you said, that COVID-19 will not totally be out of the world, it's just going to be like other sicknesses that we have already. In this instance, how would you now, do you think that people will not stop expecting, even when they know that they can always do something different, even in the midst of all of the trials and tribulations that may seem to come their way?
Let me be honest with you. Luckily for me, I mean, sorry for my modesty, I served government for 8 years as a commissioner. Then I vied to politics. I was canvassing, vying for governorship of my state. But during this process, I learned a lot. People take advantage of you. Yeah. They start asking for money to do this, to do that. Oh, their wife just had a baby. They lost their grandmother, they lost their grandfather, their child's school, future school fees, blah, blah. So you have all these things coming up without any pandemic issue. Now, some people now have turned themselves to professional beggars that you say, pandemic, we don't have any food to eat, even if they do. But the point is that just out of greed or just trying to take advantage of the situation. So I have said that government introduced some palliative measures. What are the palliative measures they introduced in Nigeria? They said some people in the north, they are getting 20. I'm not aware of that. I didn't. But what I'm aware is that many good industries, I mean, many organizations, because of the CSR, corporate social responsibility, they decided to be part of it. And what are they doing? They were donating to state governors, donating food items, face masks, drinks, and everything. And those are the items that government are now using to go to the various communities. But the problem is this. Some of these people, those various communities, and then government now sends representatives to go and deliver all these packages, palliative stimulus packages. We found out that some of them, if they are given 10 to 50 bags of rice, they probably deliver 20 bags and probably hide the remaining for themselves. So during this issue of stimulus package, there's an issue that is very key. Integrity must come to place. You must be sincere. Because if you are told to go and give the less privileged people 20, 100, 1,000 bags of Indomie or whatever it is, you must deliver it and account for it. So some people will say, oh, they didn't give it to us, or they didn't bring it. Then at times, some people will get and they deny they didn't get. So you can't tell people to start signing for a stimulus package. Okay. I'm aware, I know people in America that they got $1,200. I mean, some people I know very well, I'm close to, my daughter got $1,200 as part of the stimulus package. So what I'm saying is that this is done directly. So the point is that how do you manage it? How do you get it to the final person that will benefit from it? That is it. In America, they were able to do that. And because they have what they call records. Once you have a social security number and you're paying your tax, you're filing your handy below that, you benefit from it. But in Nigeria, how do you even determine who is qualified for stimulus package? I don't know what I'm making sense here. How do you determine? I mean, will you give me stimulus package? But in America, I may be qualified for it. In Nigeria, I may not be qualified for it. So the point is that, how do you determine what is the population of Nigeria? What is the demographic? You have to be careful about this. How many people are living? As I'm talking to you, nobody can still tell you, this is the population of Nigeria. If you say, we are between 170 and 200 million. Some people are saying over 200 million people. So the point is that, how do government sit down and ascertain who and who is qualified? The number of people. How many people are living in Lagos? How many people are living in Ogun? How many people are living in Jebode, in Abeokuta, in Kano, in Kaduna, in Abuja? You can't. So that's the reason why we have issues. We have problems in the in, 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 in allowing people to get what they deserve. It's using the discrimination. Like you see people coming in, and so that is another problem.
All right. Thank you so much for that. 4 weeks into the pandemic in the U.S., 22 million people filed for unemployment. In Nigeria, half of an organization was laid off, while some had the salaries, their salaries dramatically cut down to half or even quarter. Having seen all these, what do you think can be done to salvage the situation as regards the home front and the society at large?
Well, thank you for that question. It clearly shows that many organizations are not prepared for this. Mm. I will tell you this. I happen to be a practitioner of CSR, corporate social responsibility, and then corporate social investment. I was the director in charge when I was in the bank. But the point is that CSR is 1% profit after tax. Are you getting me?
Yeah.
So the point is, that 1% profit after tax is what you are going to use for corporate social responsibility. And I will tell you this, some organizations defined that, our focus is on health, education, and probably youth employment or employment. Some decided. So what you realize is you had some people, I remember we renovated the school in Sulere. We gave them this, we gave some students, we did some health practices. But the point is that CSR must benefit. There are two people that are beneficiaries of CSR, the internal and external stakeholders. Who are the internal stakeholders? The employer, the employees of the organization, and the internal stakeholders are either the community where you operate. And I keep on telling you that for any organization to see the kingdom of heaven, they must be socially responsible to the community where they operate. So the point is that when you are doing CSR, the money, the 1% profit after tax is the money that the employees worked for the organization to make that profit. Am I making sense here? Now, to help. So for you, CSR to your employee, the internal stakeholders, means that you must be able to provide good medical service for them. You must pay their salaries that are went due. You must make sure that they have good working environment. And you must, so my own point is that some organizations, because they are not doing well, they are using the pandemic time to lay off staff. Because I'll be honest with you, 2 months or 3 months, some organizations, I will tell you, I'm an employer of labor too. I paid salary of my staff throughout this pandemic period. But I told the only thing I told them that those of you that are in here, I will pay you your full salary. But those of you who are out there, don't come back here from now until the pandemic period. Well, I don't want anybody to come and infect the innocent people that have sacrificed. So what I did, the ones that are not working during the month, I pay them 50% of their salary. I just paid salaries too. The ones that are not, they are just seated at home. I pay them, the ones that are working here, I pay them full salary. But I compensate them. So the point is that you must be able to identify who and who qualifies for staff salary. But this is not the time to start laying off staff. It is wrong because this is a natural disaster that nobody expected. And I expect now going forward, post-pandemic, that people will now have to ensure that they are members of staff.
Now, how will governments ensure after every after the COVID-19 that every economy, that everyone is okay at last, like after the pandemic, how would government ensure that everyone is okay, there is no problem at the end of the day?
I will tell you this, and I'm sure I watch CNN virtually every day, and I see what the President of America is doing, and the President of the Prime Minister of the United States of America, United Kingdom. In Nigeria too, I see, on a daily basis, the President Task Force on COVID-19, they are briefing. You see, everybody, and that's why Mr. President set up a committee to look at the economic, development, what can happen to the economy, how can we stimulation immediately after the code and post-code and COVID. And that is why the Vice President is sharing this. He has so many members, Minister of Finance, Minister of Industry, Trade and Investment, so that they can now look at a way to gradually ease pressure and problems in Nigeria for the economic development. So the point here now is that government is looking at that. You see, no government will sit down and not making sure that his people are happy. So there are some measures that are coming up, and those are the measures, the palliative measures on how to ease things, employment provision, what needs to be done process. And I think the report will come out very soon. And with that, we need to see how government will, because I'll be honest with you, they are worried. And all the state governors who are worried. I mean, this is a very serious matter. And not only that, the cases are coming up daily on gradual basis. So the point is that there is even need to isolate the problem. And that is making sure that people are alive. If you are not alive, you cannot say you want to benefit from any economic package or palliative measures. So the point is that how do we even prevent our people from being infected with this virus? How do to them? So the point is that the social distancing, the using of the mask and avoiding, so all those things are things. So what I kept on telling people that we need to look at it whereby we must look at states where in each state, I mean, each local government, they must be able to see. I think this pandemic issue must be attacked from community area. And don't forget that people traveling, and that's why there is ban on interstate. So that no one is still traveling, so that it will reduce the pressure, and so that people will come from somewhere to come and start spreading, and the positively infected people start spreading people that are negatively infected. So they will now start infecting people, and that's why this thing will keep on spreading.
Now, in Lagos State, Nigeria, there is a new rule that just came out recently about how to nip COVID-19. In the board entirely. They came out with rules on parties, event centers, and many more. How feasible do you think this is?
I'll be honest with you, it is feasible, and I think it's been thought out by Lagos State Government, and I'm sure the other governments, other state governors will follow. You see, Lagos State Governor, I mean, I give kudos to him, and I commend him. He's done a very good job. He's actually a very great ambassador for this COVID-19. I mean, he really works that, and I personally called him to commend him on this. Let me tell you, now there are so many. The new norm must be accepted. If you cannot do that, then don't organize any party. From what I'm hearing, they're going to look at each event center. How many people can you take? What are the number of people you can take there? They're going to put ambulance there. They're going to put so many measures there. And by the time you do all this, then you'll be forced not to. Is it even compulsory for you to go to parties? Is it even compulsory for you to organize parties? People have been doing, I mean, the governor of Ogun State had his state birthday. It was on Zoom. So you can celebrate whatever you want to celebrate without people touching each other or coming around. I watched another video recently where somebody celebrated her 68th birthday or something like that in America. She sat down in front of her house with some of her children, and people were driving past, waving, dropping gifts, and going. So it clearly shows that things can change, the new norms. So the point is that we are just used to enjoyment. And so we must learn this issue, the pandemic calls for sacrifice. You must be ready to sacrifice.
I guess those are frivolous spending, so people are used to flamboyant kind of life.
It's a fun. It is a cost.
Exactly.
Now, when like Lagos State governor said, I mean, Lagos State, when he said they should come and clear their families in the morgue. And when you bury your loved ones, no more parties, no reception, just let them spray and let persons rest in peace.
Okay. Do you think that recession after COVID-19 in countries affected, worst East countries, is inevitable?
Well, let me be honest with you. There's no country that is not worst East. I heard that brother Ouagadougou and one other country in Africa have never reported any case of pandemic or coronavirus. And one state in Nigeria. But the NCDC said there was a problem, and the governor is claiming there was also. People must be realistic and be sincere. Because if you are not sincere, you're going to kill. It's like a death sentence if it's not properly managed. Something that doesn't have fast vaccine, no cure yet, but you need, if you live a normal life, because this thing will not come and meet you at home if you stay in your house. But if you go out there, you can meet it outside. It's something that flies around that will not come and meet you at home. You stay at home and you stay indoor and everything. But that is the problem. So the point is that we must look at every country all countries are Italy. I mean, they are seriously affected. But the point is that people will look at, it's just making the best, like I said, out of the bad situation. One way or the other, you will resolve it. You will look for a way of solving it and sort it out. And that is what I believe in.
Okay, on a final note, if you were called upon to share ideas on how to have a sustainable and flourishing economy after the pandemic, what would that be?
I'll be honest with you, government should now focus more on the area of healthcare services, because it clearly shows that we are not ready for something that we are not prepared for it. And if we are prepared for it medically, we won't be in this predicament. So that is one. Then the other thing is that agriculture that we lead in the organization is something we have to focus on. Food and beverages is something that we need to focus on, because these are things that, these are the areas that we need to start, I mean, growing organic food. And it clearly shows that if you are not careful, your immune system needs to be properly built up. Mm-hmm. If you are not healthy, you cannot work for a betterment of an economy. So what I'm saying is that government should now focus on how people can work at home, and at the same time, the benefits, and encourage people to be very creative, innovative, so that they will help the economy. This is not the issue of government alone. You must involve everybody. Everybody should be involved in this. And that is my advice.
Okay, so in a nutshell, we are all in this together. So it's not just government, it's everybody. So let's endeavor to actually put our hands on deck and help ourselves survive the economy or the whatever may come after COVID-19. Otumba, I'm really very grateful. Thank you so much for being part of this show. Thank you for coming.
Thank you so much for having me. And I will leave with this saying that heaven helps those who help themselves. So we must help us in order to stay safe and keep safe with our beautiful family.
Thank you so much. Thank you too for being part of the show today. Thank you so much for always watching Let's Talk. Until next time, I remain Olujake. Bye for now.